this video, I'm going to talk about beam spreading, the angle of incidence, and the sun angle, and how those affect the heating and the energy distribution of our atmosphere. Sort of briefly, anyway. So I'm sitting in a sandbox. I'm sitting beside a sandbox. We use this in our terrain modeling lab at Murray State University. It's a nice little sandbox we can use to help recreate and model an environment. So I thought what I would do is the archaeologists and the hydrologists like to use these to kind of show students how different landforms can be constructed by basically the movement of running water, you know, how it carves our landscape. And so I'm using their sandbox today. I've populated it with some trees, and these are actually monopoly houses that I'm using. So that kind of helps set the stage. We've got a little mound back here that's probably an Indian burial mound because I do work with archaeologists every day. And they built some pyramids out here in the background. So I thought about maybe creating a little Stonehenge, and then we could recreate some of the solstices and some of the equinox and stuff like that. But that's way more elaborate than I wanted to be for this video. So basically what I wanted to show you today was this idea of beam spreading and how the sun's angle of incidence versus the Earth and how that Earth-Sun geometry contributes towards the intensity of the energy which we receive here. And so my flashlight's going to act as my sun. So it's going to be my source of energy. So my flashlight is my sun. This is my source of energy. I'm going to shine my sun down on top of these monopoly houses. Now they're not going to melt because this flashlight is not that powerful. But my point is this. Is right now, we have a very confined area of intense illumination on these houses. My source of energy, my flashlight or my sun, is directly above those houses. And so what I would do is I would, if this piece of wood represents the surface of the Earth, the beam of light, my radiation is striking the Earth at essentially a 90 degree angle with respect to this surface. So we have the beam coming down this way, the rays of the sun hitting or striking perpendicular to my ground, and so it's basically this angle here. And so that plays an important role because that does happen. We do have periods throughout our revolution around the sun where the sun is directly overhead locations on the Earth. Now, if you want to look at a chart that sort of describes this, you would look at a chart that has a special name called analemma. So an analemma helps you figure out where the sun is going to be directly overhead given the date and time. Usually it's solar noon. Okay, so the question now becomes, what happens when the sun's angle changes with respect to the Earth's surface? Okay, so as I change the angle at which my sun's rays are striking the Earth's surface, it may be hard to see in this video, I hope not, but this blob of light is becoming more diffuse. So the energy leaving my flashlight really hasn't changed, but what's happening is that the area that energy is affecting is changing. It's actually, if we could measure that energy being received here, it would be less. So, and the amount of energy change is directly related to the change in the angle. So right now, 90 degrees is the angle directly overhead. So if you take the sine, it's actually the sine of the angle of incidence. So if you take the sine of the angle of incidence of 90 degrees, you should arrive at 1. So if there's 10 watts per square meter striking the Earth here, I don't know if there is, but I'm just going to say hypothetically speaking, if there's 10 watts per square meter of energy striking the Earth here, and I multiply that times the incidence angle, which is 1, or times the sine of 90, which is 1, I still get 10. Okay, so what happens if I change my angle to maybe, say, 45 degrees? So you would take the sine of 45 degrees and multiply it times this energy, 10, and you would get roughly 7. So now we're not talking about 7 watts per square meter. We're not talking about 10 watts per square meter anymore. We're talking about, I think it's roughly about 7. About 7 watts per square meter. Now if I drop my angle of incidence down to 30 degrees, again, the energy hasn't changed, the amount of energy leaving my flashlight hasn't changed, but now that it's become much more diffuse, the intensity is quite less. If you take the sine of 30 degrees, it should be 0.5, and 0.5 times 10 is 5 watts. So now we've, by changing the angle to 30 degrees with respect to the Earth's surface, now we're only getting about half, that the energy is only about half as intense as it was when the sun was directly overhead. Now when the sun is directly overhead and you're looking at your analemma, you'll notice that it stops in the north at 23.5 and in the south at 23.5 degrees. So when the sun is the farthest north the sun travels overhead and can still be directly overhead, or at least have the rays meet at 90 degrees, is 23.5 degrees north. And that becomes what we call the Tropic of Cancer. Now, in the southern hemisphere, at 23.5 degrees south, which is the furthest the sun will traverse and can possibly be overhead, that is what we call the Tropic of Capricorn. Now, this does have some very real implications for industry, because there's been a lot of interest in solar energy lately. So, with solar energy, you want to be able to capture as many daylight days as you can, days of daylight as you can, and you also want to orient your solar panels so that they can capture the best amount of energy that can reach them. And so that geometry between the sun and the solar panels is very important. That's why some companies will develop solar panels that will adjust themselves as the sun passes overhead, so that it will maximize the sun angle and capture the highest amount of radiation possible. So I hope the idea of beam spreading, the sun angle, and the angle of incidence helps explain how the changing relationship, the changing Earth and sun geometry, helps in the warming of the Earth.